Oh yeah. I'm not the type of brother to play with. See a lot of people acting like a, oh yeah. Old ball players sounding like haters. We the young kings of this generation, oh yeah. What is up, everybody? Welcome back. Pitchside with Parker, and today we are celebrating 100 subscribers. First of all, I just want to say thank you so much to everybody who is subscribed, to everybody who is watching the video, anybody who comes across this, man. The support has been so awesome. We've gotten to 100 a lot quicker than I thought we were going to. And I know, as I said in the last video, it's not that crazy of a number. Like, a lot of people will probably look at that and say, ah, whatever, it's 100 subscribers. But it's something about that three digits that is really cool to me. And I'm just really happy with it. And I want to see it keep going up. And so this is just another milestone and a mark of hopefully a lot more to come. I am a little disappointed that I couldn't do a giveaway this time around. I want to keep making that like a thing on the channel, but as I said in the last video, I think I set my standards just a little too high with that first giveaway at 50 subs. But here's what we are going to do is at the next milestone, which to me is 250, I am going to do another giveaway. So my next big goal is 250. Can we get that done by New Year's? That's my goal. It might be a little lofty, but I think 250 subs by the end of the year, I think it's reasonable. So help me get there, man. Share this channel. Share the videos you like with your friends. I think that's the number one way to help me grow, really. That and liking the videos. I need y'all to keep up the support on that as well. Like the videos as soon as they come on. And if we do that, the channel's gonna keep growing because that helps more people see the videos. And when more people see the videos, more people subscribe. So share with your friends, keep liking the videos. And if you're new here, if this is the first time you've seen a video, or if you've seen a couple but you're not quite sure, hit the subscribe button right now and turn on the post notifications so that you know when new videos come out. But yeah, that's a lot of rambling. We are here to do the Q&A video. That's how we're celebrating 100 subscribers. And I wanted to give you guys a chance to just, I guess, get to know me a little bit better, or basically pick the topics for a video, essentially, because I put any question on the table, you know, I'd be happy to answer it. And you guys came through with some really good questions. So let's just jump straight into those. Why not? The first question comes from Jackson Lamar. Man, Jackson, shout out. I've been seeing you commenting on the videos, and you pulled up to the live the other day. Appreciate the question. He says, who's your favorite Arsenal player ever? And who's your favorite current squad player, and why is it Saka? Well, first of all, Jackson, you're right. It is Saka. That is definitely my favorite current squad player at Arsenal. I just love the guy. Like, it's just something about him. I think last season it was like him and Martinelli side by side, as, you know, they brought some life to the team. And then obviously Martinelli getting hurt, we just got to keep seeing more of Saka. But man, I just love the way he plays. He's so creative. And I think a lot of people know about my love for Ozil, my love for Emi Martinez, although he's gone now. He was one of my favorite players. You can't help but love Aubameyang, obviously. So there's a lot of likable players, but to me, yeah, Bukayo Saka is number one right now. Favorite players on the current squad. I need to get a jersey, so maybe I'll treat myself at Christmas or something like that. And then favorite Arsenal player ever. This is a tougher one for me, but I think I'd have to go with Thierry Henry. I think that's like a shoo-in for a lot of people, but I never actually really got to see Henry play. For those who don't know my background as much, like, I'm 22. Arsenal's the only, like, my always been my favorite team, but I just didn't really have access, or I guess went out of my way to watch a lot of soccer until I was really like in high school. So I never saw Henry growing up. The only time I really saw Henry was when he came back to Arsenal briefly. But like, when I go back and look at Henry's highlights, I'm just captivated by him. I don't do that for a lot of players, but when I see Henry highlights, I can just tell that if I was watching and following Arsenal a lot when he was in his prime, 2000 to like 2006, I just know he would have been my favorite player. He was just so incredible to watch. The swagger, the confidence, the creativity. I loved it. So yeah, I go with Henry as my favorite player ever. So next question comes from FS Dreams. Thank you for the question. They said, how long you've been playing soccer, and do you play any other sports? I played soccer as long as I can remember, really. Like, that was always my first sport. My mom played soccer her whole life, so she, I think, was a big influence on that. Literally, she told me that like my first word was ball, so it was from a very young age, for sure. And it's the only sport I've ever played competitively. I love basketball as well. I played like in church leagues, and honestly, I came up playing basketball just running pickup like at courts by my house. And I wish there was that kind of thing for soccer growing up, honestly, because that was just what I had access to. And I never played basketball in a league, but I really enjoyed it. And I feel like if I had played soccer that way growing up, I would have really loved playing like that and would have kind of developed my love for the game earlier. But yeah, I also love basketball. So yeah, soccer and basketball are the only two I really play seriously, but I love playing all type of sports. Next question. Okay, this one comes from Joseph Glenn. And Joseph, if you're watching this, I want to say thank you. You left a ton of comments on my videos, and I always see them. I always try to respond to them. He's been leaving a lot of comments on the women's soccer videos, and he said, as I mentioned in an earlier comment, you need to give the Dash some respect, i.e. the 4-1 trouncing of NC Courage this evening. Also, Christy Mewis assisted on 3 of those points and scored her own. Keep up the good work. Yes, when I posted the video that was asking for your questions, it was the night that Courage played Houston Dash. So I was at work when that happened. If you watch the video, like, I was really at work, so I couldn't watch the game. But I did go back and watch the highlights, and you're right, Mewis balled out. But I will say that was against kind of like a second choice team for NC Courage. So I would try not to like take too much from it, but that doesn't mean that Mewis and like Shea Groom and all them aren't ballers. They definitely are. And I don't know how you say I don't put respect on Houston Dash. You could go all the way back on my channel. Like, before I had even picked an NWSL team, Houston Dash was my favorite team during the Challenge Cup. I literally made a video. I'm pretty sure the title is "The Houston Dash are my new favorite team." So, nah, I hear you. I definitely put respect on Houston Dash. And I appreciate the continued comments from you as well. You've been helping me, you know, pick up things and learn, especially on the women's soccer side. As I've said in some of my women's soccer videos, I'm still pretty new to the club game, and I like trying to learn, and any corrections people have, like, I really appreciate those. But yeah, thank you to Joseph for the question, and, you know, keep up the comments. I appreciate it. And then next up, Patrick Indy dropped me 3 different questions. Patrick, thank you so much. This really helped, you know, give me some good questions for the video. You know, he's another day one supporter as well. Big shout out to Indy. He says, the first question was, what are your general thoughts on VAR and how would you like to see it used moving forward? This is a big question. I mean, I won't dive into it too far, but my basic opinion on VAR is that most of the issues and the things that people get mad about, I would say, have more to do with, first of all, the rules, and second of all, the referees who are making the decisions. I think on the whole, VAR is a net positive, and I think that its introduction has made the game better. If you think about just some of the historic moments that teams got unfairly knocked out of tournaments, like, I think of like Germany and England in the World Cup with that goal, I think it was from Gerrard or something, that went crossbar down, they didn't call it. That's something where VAR would have totally fixed that. Or I think about Arsenal and Barcelona in the Champions League, I want to say 2010, 2011, something like that, when Van Persie got the second yellow card and it was some nonsense, and like VAR might have been able to rule that out. So I think on the whole, it does help. I think even with offside, I know that makes a lot of people mad, but I'm in the camp where it's like, you're either onside or you're offside. It's a very simple rule. Yes, I know it comes down to these little tiny measurements, but it's either a right or wrong call. So I think VAR helps with that. The issue to me has been with the handball stuff, but I think that has a lot more to do with the rules and the referees applying the rules, especially in England. The referees are just terrible. Even when they're given access to good VAR and stuff, they still make bad decisions. What I would like to see change going forward is that now that VAR is in place, and I don't think it's going to go anywhere anytime soon, they need to update the rules to get in line with VAR. That's kind of my opinion on it. So Indy's second question, he said, what teams do you find yourself supporting outside Arsenal and why? There's a long list for sure. I get enamored with teams really quickly. I think a common pattern of it as well is like, I've covered a lot of teams in the past, and in my experience as like a journalist or a broadcaster, once you start broadcasting or covering a team and you start to learn the stories of the players and all of that, it's hard not to start being a fan of them as well. So in college for me, that meant definitely Northwestern was my number one team, like especially the Northwestern women's team, because the men's team was pretty bad, but the women's team was really good. They've got 3 alumni in the NWSL right now. Yeah, I that was one of my favorite teams. Like, I would literally, that was appointment viewing for me, you know, the last couple of years. Like, I would sit down, if I couldn't go to the game myself or if I wasn't broadcasting, I would sit down at home, put it on the TV. Like, that was big for me. on the women's side, as I said before, I think Houston Dash is like my new favorite team. Basically, I love the way they play and I love a lot of their players. In terms of men's, my like little brother team always in the Premier League has been Crystal Palace. I feel like when I was in high school and I started getting really into the Prem, I always just love their fans. Like their ground at Selhurst Park is so cool. And I mean, I've liked a lot of their players too, especially like I'm a big fan of Zaha. I don't know. There's just always been something about Crystal Palace. They've always kind of been my like second team in the Prem. And then the other men's team I would throw in there is Atlanta United in terms of the US context. I don't watch a ton of MLS, but I worked in Atlanta last year. So like early 2019, and it was right after they had won the MLS Cup. And I mean, they were like the team, you know, they had high expectations and it's gone very south from there, but I just love Atlanta United. I got to write a story on their homegrown players, like the players that essentially came up through their academy. And then I covered a game there as well. And they're just an awesome team and their fan base is great. The stadium there is so cool. Like there's a lot to love about Atlanta United, even though things have been rough there as well. And then the last team I would throw in there, I know I've listed a bunch of teams, but Sweden is my international team, for those who don't know. I have some Swedish heritage in my family. And Sweden, y'all might not know, is one of only three different teams in the last men's and last women's World Cup that made the quarterfinals with both the men's and the women's team. The only other teams to do that were France and England. So, you know, put some respect on Sweden. Zlatan was always like one of my favorite players growing up. And on the women's side, Aslani is one of my favorite players for Sweden. So yeah, Sweden would round out the list of like my favorite teams. And then his final question is, what do you believe is the cause of disparity in the level of the Team USA men's and women's teams? Women's have been dominant winning several World Cups while the men can't even qualify for the World Cup. Oh wow, that's a loaded question. But I would say there's two kind of main factors in that. I would say the first one is just relative to the competition. There's been a lot more progress and investment in the women's side compared to other nations around the world. There's so many countries that could have great women's teams that still don't. I mean, that was something that Jennifer Cujo talked about in her interview that I did with her on the channel in regards to Ghana. Like there's so much talent, but they don't have the right, you know, progressive attitude and respect for the women's team. So I think that's one thing that helps set apart the US women's team. And then the other thing is because of the disparities in the men's and the women's game, international soccer became so much more big of a deal, both between the World Cup and the Olympics, in comparison to club, because that was, for the women, that was the way you get seen on the big stage, is that if you're competing in the Olympics, or, you know, you look at the success that the Women's World Cup has had in terms of viewership, for a long, long time, it dwarfed the numbers of people that watch club games. And I'm not totally sure on the ratings these days, but I do think those are starting to even out a little bit, where more people are watching the club game. And most of that has to do with who is putting it on TV, because historically with women's soccer, there's always been an audience when it has been on TV. The issue has been networks haven't wanted to put it on. Yeah, I would say that's a big factor as well, just is the prevalence of the international game with the women's, and it's just so much more importance put on that. Whereas I think for the USA, like, even though they aren't very good, American players are still like, oh, well, I can still succeed, you know, trying to be good at a club level or whatever. So I would say those are kind of two main factors in that. But it's very complex and it's a pretty loaded question. So yeah, that's basically all the questions. There was one more from somebody that kind of looks like a fake account, I'll be honest. But they said, I hope you have a successful channel. So you know what? I'll end on that note and say thank you to this account, which the name looks a little suspect, so I'm not even going to say that. But I'm going to pretend like it's a nice comment. Thank you. Thank you to everybody who dropped questions on this video. It's been a lot of fun to make, and I hope that, you know, y'all enjoyed watching it and got a little more knowledge and insight into me and who I am a little bit outside of just what I say in the videos. And I do just want to say, man, like, this is only going to get so much better. We're still, as much as I'm happy with a lot of the stuff that I've been able to come out with, there's still so much room to grow here, and I'm still so excited about everything that's to come with the YouTube channel. I have a lot of ideas, and I know that there's so many things that I can get better at. I can get better at editing, and I mean, I'm still putting out the videos in like 540p. So to the people, the first 100 people, right, to everybody who's been watching these videos and subscribed, and especially those who are leaving comments and liking the videos and everything. I just can't say thank you enough, because y'all see the potential even when the graphics aren't perfect and the video quality isn't amazing and there's not as many people around. Y'all still see it. Y'all still see the vision, and y'all still see the grind that I've been putting in. And I just want to say thank you for that. And it's not going to stop. It's only going to keep going up for here. So, you know, you'll always be able to say you were those people that were around from the beginning. And man, I appreciate it so much. So with that being said, the road to 250 starts here. That's going to be the next big goal. I think we can get it by the end of the year. And with a little help from you, I'm certainly going to keep putting in the work. And I think it's going to happen. So thanks for watching the video. If y'all don't see me a whole lot over the next couple weeks, obviously there's the international break and the new FIFA's coming out, so you know, I might have to put some hours into that. But that being said, you know, I'll still make some videos too, but if it slows down a little bit, that might be why, at least for the next couple of weeks. But anyway, thanks for watching the video, and yeah, I'll catch you in the next one. Peace.